forgive us those things that weigh on our conscience, and give us those good things that come only through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Thank you.
pray as John taught his disciples. He said to them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins. For we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. Do not bring us to the time of trial.'" And he said to them, "Suppose one of you has a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say to him, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has arrived, and I have nothing to set before him.' And he answers from within, 'Do not bother me. The door has already been locked, and my children are in bed with me. I cannot get up and give you anything.' I tell you, even though he will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, at least because of his persistence, he will get up and give him whatever he needs. So I say to you, ask and it will be given you. Search and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives, and everyone who searches finds. And for everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Is there anyone among you who, if your child asks for a fish, will give a snake instead of a fish? Or if the child asks for an egg, will give a scorpion? You then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace from our loving God, Father, Son, and A 4-year-old boy was asked to give thanks as the family sat down for a holiday meal. The family all bowed their heads in expectation, and he began to pray. He thanked God for all of his friends, naming them one by one, of course. Then he thanked God for mommy, daddy, brother, sister, grandma, grandpa, and all his aunts and uncles. Then he moved to the food. He thanked God for the turkey, dressing, the fruit salad, the cranberry sauce, the pies, the cakes, even the Kool Whip. Then he paused, and everyone waited and waited. And after a long silence, the young boy looked up at his mom and asked, "If I thank God for the broccoli, won't he know that I'm lying?" When I think of my early memories with prayer, I think of the times my sister and I stayed at our grandma's house as kids. The bedtime routine in her house always looked the same, and it included prayers, where I learned the Lord's Prayer by memory, actually. And then those prayers were followed by a tight tucking in of the night. In those moments, Grandma O modeled for my sister and I faithful conversation with God, and I give thanks for that gift. We find the topic of prayer at the heart of our readings this week. The seemingly simple act can bring with it a great deal of baggage, though. Maybe you too are recalling your early memories of prayer. It's possible you heard Jesus' invitation to pray and felt shame regarding how infrequently you pray. Perhaps you are wondering what the point of prayer really is after. We might be recalling the prayers that seem to have been left unanswered, resulting in more pain than we care to share. Of course, too, there is the feeling of discomfort one might experience when being asked to pray in front of a group. Our confirmation students can speak too well to that, but I've seen that in many settings, including among classmates in seminary. Some of us have been praying as long as we can remember, yet we find that it does not make this conversation less complicated. In Genesis, we meet Abraham as God is preparing to destroy the people of Sodom and Gomorrah for the sins that they have committed. They have fallen short, and we read that they will face the consequences. That is, until Abraham speaks up. Abraham pleads with God. What if there are 50 upright people in the land? And see God step back, agreeing to grant mercy if there are 50 found. The The same is true if only 45, 40, 30, 20, and yes, even if there are only 10 upright people to be found, there mercy shall come. In the Gospel of Luke, we see Jesus do a lot of praying. He prayed as he and others were baptized. He prays in deserted places after curing those that he's met. We see him pray on a mountain as he prepares to call the 12 disciples. And even as he asks Peter, who people say that he is, we read that Jesus is praying. His disciples are moved by a desire to learn how to pray. And notice we read that they don't ask Jesus, but instead they tell him to teach them. It is here that we get the Lord's Prayer, Jesus' model for how we might pray to our Father in heaven. Jesus shares that God answers when we knock. God wakes up and helps even at a burdensome hour. God gives even more than a loving parent gives. As we consider these prayers in our lessons today, we cannot help but see how bold they are, while also noticing that they are spoken from a place of humility. Abraham does not say what God can and cannot do, but he does remind God of God's justice, mercy, and love. Abraham does not say this from a place of privilege or authority, but humbly asks God to act on God's life-giving qualities that we all give thanks for. The disciples, too, are bold in their demand to learn from Jesus how to pray. Give us our daily bread. Forgive us our sins. This prayer, too, seeks for God to act as God acts time and again in the forming of creation and the navigating of continued human brokenness at the cross on which Christ died. This prayer that Jesus models invites us to celebrate and honor who it is that our God is, while seeking God's continued good work in our world. Whether we pray silently or aloud, kneeling or sitting, whether our prayer is one of confession, telling, praising, thanking, or asking, we read today that at the heart of it all should lie a bold trust in God's presence, God's life-giving qualities of love, justice, and mercy, and God's care for us that far exceeds even that of a loving earthly parent. To pray is to lay our needs before God as Abraham did, trusting full well that God will show us, and that God will act. Jesus does not set before us the task of writing the most elaborate prayers known to man, prayers to be published in words. Nor does he promise that we will get everything we want or desire. He invites us to be genuine in our conversations with God, adding that we will receive what we need. We are promised that God will always choose love, justice, mercy, and mercy. We are reminded, too, that the Spirit will meet us as our prayers arise. When speaking of prayer with parishioners or teaching about prayer, my internship supervisor often referred to the act as a stumbling with God. As we leave this place, as we continue on our journey as Christ's pilgrims, let us dare to stumble through conversation. Let us be bold in our trust that God will continue to show up and act as God always has. Love, justice, and mercy. Let's pray too from a place of humility, amazed, and so deeply grateful for all that God has done in our lives and the lives of others. Let us ask that we might receive. Search that we might find, and knock so that the door might be opened by our loving parent in heaven. Together, all God's people say. Amen.
trusting in God's extraordinary love, let us come near to the Holy One in prayer. Rooted and built up in Christ, we pray for the church, emboldening church leaders to take risks for the sake of the gospel, and equip the baptized to proclaim your extravagant love for the whole world. Merciful God, rejoicing in the works of your hands, we pray for the natural world. Make rivers and lakes, oceans and all waterways sparkle with your radiance. Protect water sources near our home, St. River and Lake Huron, and strengthen those who defend them. Merciful God, interceding on behalf of the vulnerable, we pray for the peoples of the world. Inspire all rulers and governing authorities with your justice. Guide the work of legislators and public officials that they advocate for the well-being of those they serve. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Persistent in prayer, we pray for our neighbors in need. To all who have hunger, we give bread. To all who have bread, give to hunger for justice. Open us to the cries of those who suffer, especially those who remain now silently or alone. Merciful God, abounding in thanksgiving, we pray for this congregation. Bless the prayer and fellowship ministries in this place. Call us together in times of praise and blessing, trouble and sorrow. In your holy name, merciful God, bearing with Christ in baptism, and raised with him to life, we give thanks for your saints who rest in your eternal presence. Join our voices with theirs as we sing of your great glory. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Receive the prayers of your children, merciful God, and hold us forever in your steadfast love. Through Jesus Christ, our holy wisdom. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace with one another.
Thank you.
We stand in body and spirit to do it. Let us pray. God of abundance,
you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field, and equip us to bear fruit for good of all. In the name of Jesus, amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray, life-giving God,
through this meal you have bandaged our wounds and fed us with your mercy. Now send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Please be seated for the announcements. First announcement is SOS Noisy Offering Collection will be next week. So we've been talking about that for a few weeks now. SOS is in urgent need of food and help, and so we're going to drop in all the change that we can find in our house and our purses and our wallets, whatever it is, next week. So we'll hear all kinds of noise clanging in the back for them. BBS registration is continuing on. We have partnered with United Methodist Church here in Marysville and are really excited about Abundance Orchard. It's going to be a great BBS program. If you sign up to volunteer but don't know what you're doing yet, you will very soon. I promise that's coming. But we did get your shirt sizes. If we didn't already, let me know today so we'll get that for you too. But registration for kids is open now. Please go ahead and encourage your young ones to sign up. Our maintenance / custodian position remains open and available. And so if you feel really moved to put in a few hours here at the church, dusting cobwebs and picking up garbage and all the important things that happen here behind the scenes, please let myself or someone from the Board of Administration know, which looks like it's Mark today. So if you're interested, see Mark afterwards. You'll notice too that the ramp is still here and that some lights aren't yet on. So we have had a really dedicated crew of three in here on a lift, working hard. They ran into a few snags on Thursday, but they are working hard and they're going to get that up and running. And so we thank them for their extremely hard work and dedication over many hours this week and continuing on next week. And last but not least, we had a new acolyte today who did a wonderful job. And so we thank him for that. And David stepping in on piano, which is also
opportunity to give my farewell after 37 years. About a week, or less than a week, I'm going to be giving the keys to our home in Merritt Road there to the new owner, and I'll be moving to Florida full time this year. Judy and our family joined Pilgrim in 1983. Tom Shaner was the pastor. In the months and years to follow, we were blessed to watch Pilgrim grow and prosper. We also suffered sorrow with the deaths of both parishioners and family members, including my wife, Judy, and my son, BJ. So, don't let the distances keep us apart. Come visit me in Florida whenever you're in the area. I left some address cards out by where the portals are. So, you can come and visit, and I plan to make at least one visit every year around this time for a week or so, just to catch up with friends. My association with Pilgrim brought me many friends, and I treasure all of you. I especially enjoy working with the men's club and helping with the dinners. I'm having an estate sale starting this Friday, if anybody's interested, this coming Friday, at 100 Marin. We've got 50 years worth of stuff for sale. All at garage sale prices. Thank you.
July 23rd. All are welcome to come.
March 23rd, and it's still good there. Did you do an announcement or just wait?
No.
August. He's ready. If it's okay, can we have a quick prayer as we send Bill on his way? Is that okay? Lord be with you. God, we give you thanks for the way that you knit your community together in the waters of baptism. People that, you know, maybe we wouldn't necessarily meet in our own circles, but people you bring into our lives here in this place. We give you thanks for Bill's witness to the gospel. We give you thanks for Bill's commitment to this place and his role in events that we love so dearly. God, as he goes forth, we ask that you guide him, lead him, as you have throughout so many years in this place. Help him find a place of worship, a community as loving and welcoming as this has been. We pray this in the name of your Son, Christ our Lord.